Episode of EPOL Experts. We've reached episode 8. My name is Stefan Jacobs, National Technical Sales Manager at EPOL Animal Feed. And today we're looking at disease management, and our resident expert today will be Andrew van Wyk, Dr. Andrew van Wyk. He's our regional veterinarian in the Western Cape District, looking after the RCL farms on the broiler and breeder side. So Andrew is going to tell us a bit more about disease management, a nice practical presentation, and we'll also cover some questions and answers afterwards. Just before we start with Andrew's presentation, a friendly reminder that because this is a disease management presentation, there will be quite some graphical images throughout the presentation. Just understand that it's purely for educational purposes and to further enlighten the subject. So without any further ado, Andrew, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stefan, and thank you, EPOL, for the opportunity to be presenting on your series. So good afternoon, everyone. As Stefan said, today we're looking at disease management. So just to remind you again, as you said, some photos may upset sensitive viewers, but it's purely for educational purposes. So what will we be covering today? So firstly, I'm going to look at two conditions which mainly affect chicks within the first 7 days of life. The first one is umphalitis, or also known as mushy chick. The second one is aspergillosis, which is a fungal disease causing lung infection. And then we're going to be looking at two viral conditions of broilers which are usually slightly older, and that is Newcastle disease and then also infectious bursal disease. And then we'll be looking at how to identify broiler health problems. And lastly, before the Q&A session, we'll be looking at how to prevent these broiler health problems. So the first condition we look at today is umphalitis, or mushy chicks. So umphalitis is a mixed bacterial infection of the yolk sac. So what is the yolk sac? For those of you who don't know what the yolk sac is, well, when you buy an egg from the shop that you are eating, you'll see that there's obviously the round yellow part, which is the yolk. And then the white part, after you've cooked it, that's the albumin. So the function of the yolk in the incubation of the egg, the yolk provides the nutrients as well as the antibodies to the developing embryo. And the embryo is attached to the yolk via the umbilical cord. And as the embryo develops, it absorbs the nutrients and the antibodies from the yolk. And then over this 21-day incubation period, that's how long it takes for a chicken egg to hatch. During this 21-day incubation period, the embryo becomes bigger, and over time, the yolk becomes smaller. I'm going to show you some photos now of the developing embryo. So infection of the yolk sac. So as I said, the yolk sac is rich in nutrients. It's got liquid in there. So because even though it's embryo, unfortunately, it's also good for bacteria, as bacteria also like food and they like moisture. So the most common cause of mushy chicks or umphalitis is infection with E. coli. It could also be from Klebsiella or pneumonia bacteria, but most commonly the causative agent is Escherichia coli bacteria. And then this results in umphalitis. So umphalitis means an infection of the yolk and also infection of the umbilical stump, which is where the umbilical cord was. And then also it leads to an increased mortality. Most commonly, the mortalities from umphalitis spikes at about 3 to 4 days of age. So you typically see day one, day two, the mortalities are still with the normal limits. And then by day three and day four, it spikes. And then by day five and six, it usually comes down. So the infection is through either contamination of eggs with fecal material and also through annealed navels after placement. So the clinical signs of umphalitis is the birds appear depressed and dejected. So these birds usually they've got a systemic infection because it spreads from the yolk sac into the body of the chick. So therefore they'll typically have a fever and they're not feeling very well. They'll have a swollen, tense abdomen because of this enlarged and inflamed yolk sac. They'll have a loss of appetite, and they also have diarrhea. So as I've pointed out, this is the picture showing how the chicken embryos develop during incubation. So what we've done here is we've taken the shells as well as the shell membranes off, and here you see the yolk and the albumin as well as the developing embryo. So during this 21-day incubation period, You can see how the embryo, here from about day 6, you can start seeing the embryo with the naked eye. From day 3, already you can start seeing the heart and or heartbeat and blood vessels. And then over this 21-day period, the embryo gradually gets bigger and the yolk gets smaller. And then after 19 days of incubation, roughly between 19 and 20 days, the embryo will then draw the yolk into the peritoneal cavity or the abdomen, and it does it via the navel. So the chick lives off the yolk, and then it draws the yolk into the abdomen. And then when the chick hatches, so by the time you get the chick onto your broiler farm, it will still have the yolk, but the yolk is inside the peritoneal cavity. So when you open up dead chickens, usually for the first 5 or 6 days, it's normal to still find the yolk inside the abdominal cavity. Then here's two pictures of chicks suffering from umphalitis or mushy chicks. So you can see the one here on the left, there's an infected and inflamed. So inflamed, you can see there how inflamed these arteries are, they're much and they're visible. And then you can also see the content of this of the yolk. This is abnormal. It's usually foul smelling as well. It doesn't smell very nice. Normal yolk doesn't have a foul smell. And then the picture on the right, what you can see here again is the swelling of the abdomen. So this chick has got an enlarged abdomen. And you can also see the inflammation. You can see all these arteries here. This is abnormal. And as you can see here, it usually starts off by the umbilical cord or the navel, which is here where I'm pointing now. So here's another picture of 4 chicks which died from mushy chick. As you can see, especially in this chick here, this is not a good quality navel. You can see good quality umbilical cord. You can see there's a large scab, and then you can also see the inflammation and of the arteries around the umbilical cord. So potential sources of infection, it can happen either at the breeder farm during the collection and storage of the eggs, or it can happen at the hatchery, or less likely but also possible, if conditions at your broiler farm is not favorable, then chicks can also be exposed at the broiler farm. But most commonly, it occurs at the breeder farm or the hatchery, where there's contamination of the eggs in the nest boxes. So at the breeder farm, if the nest box hygiene is not good, and the guys there don't put fresh shavings in the nest boxes and keep it clean, that can lead to infection of the egg shell. There can be contaminated egg rooms on the breeder farms. There can also be contamination during egg collection. So if the collectors on the breeder farm don't practice good hygiene during collection, they can also contaminate the eggs. If the breeder birds do have enteritis, so if they've got an inflammation of the intestines, or if they've got an egg yolk peritonitis where the egg moves down the oviduct, that can also then lead to mushy chicks. If the eggs become wet from the rain or moisture from condensation, that can either be during loading at the breeder farm or when offloading the eggs at the hatchery. As I pointed out previously, bacteria like moisture, that will then also can also lead to mushy chicks. If the egg truck, which transports the eggs from the farm to the hatchery, is contaminated, that can also lead to mushy chicks. Also, unhygienic hatchery condition, the hatchery should be a very clean place. And then also, if the fumigation procedures at the hatchery is not adequate, that can also lead to mushy chicks. What also could happen if the incubation isn't optimal and the navel of the chick hasn't healed properly, that can also, if the navel is either open or if the navel is, sometimes they refer to the umbilical as being a string or a button, that can also lead or predispose to infection of the yolk. So what do we see on post-mortem with mushy chicks? So when the chicks have died and we open them up, we do a post-mortem. We see a distended abdomen, as we saw in the photos, with a foul-smelling, watery content. We see reddening and edema. So edema means it's swollen in the umbilical region. You must also look for unhealed navels. So look what the condition of the navel is. You can even do that in the healthy chick as well that you get on your farm. Always inspect the navel. And from the previous presentations on the EPOL series, you would have seen what a good quality navel should look like. And then the diagnosis, it's through postmortem. If you want to, you can also take swabs of the bacterial content of the yolk and send it to a lab for culture. Then they can determine if it is indeed E. coli or if there's other bacteria involved. The treatment for mushy chick, antibiotics could be indicated in the acute stages. However, the prognosis for chicks which show obvious yolk sac infections, and most of them will die by 7 days. So mushy chicks is something which should be addressed with the hatchery, and then the hatchery must also address with the breeder farms to make sure that those predisposing factors are addressed. And as I said, prevention is through good hygiene and biosecurity practice at the breeder farm and also at the hatchery, and also optimal incubation conditions to make sure that the chicks which hatch from the hatchery is good quality chicks with a well-heeled navel. That then brings us to the second condition of chicks which we'll be looking at today, that is aspergillosis. So aspergillosis is a fungal infectious disease. It's also called fungal pneumonia, so it's a fungal infection causing infection of the lungs. It is mainly caused by Aspergillus fumigatus, although there could also be other species of fungi present, but mostly it's caused by Aspergillus fumigatus, or it could be other Aspergillus species. The typical sign that you see on the broiler farm is gasping for air, so they've got an open mouth gasping, which I'll show you photos of soon, and we see it especially in the young chicks. The incubation period for this condition is 2 to 5 days. So the term incubation period means it's the time lapsed from exposure to the pathogen, so in this case the fungus, until clinical signs are seen. So chicks will develop these symptoms within 2 to 5 days after they've been exposed to the fungi. The mortality among young affected chicks can be up to 50%. So don't underestimate the importance of Aspergillus. Usually it wouldn't kill 50% of your flock, but in severe infections, you can lose a lot of birds. And with the remaining 50% which do survive, they will also be affected and the uniformity will not be good. So how are chicks exposed to Aspergillus? The exposure is either through inhalation from an environment with a high spore count. And this environment is typically at the hatchery during the final stages of incubation. So as I said, the incubation of a chicken egg is 21 days, but the chicks, they start pipping, so they start coming out of the eggs from 19 and 20 days. And if that environment in the hatchery has got a high fungal spore count, then the chicks, soon after they have hatched, they will be inhaling a large number of spores, and that will predispose them to an early infection with Aspergillus. But then the second potential source of infection, which is very important and shouldn't be underestimated, is bedding on your broiler farm. So the bedding, whether it's shavings or whether it's sawdust or sunflower husks or peanut husk or rice husk or whatever you use, or straw, these also pose a very big risk. So chicks can either be exposed at the hatchery or they can be exposed on the broiler farm. And typically when they're exposed at the hatchery, we see deaths early, so then they die day 1, 2, 3 at your farm. And if they're exposed at the farm, then typically we see mortalities from day 3 and 4 onwards. And then bird-to-bird transmission is rare. So the birds are exposed through the environment, either through the bedding or at the hatchery, but the transmission from one bird to other birds is low. So what are the signs of aspergillosis? As I've said, they're weak, they gasp, and they're thirsty, and they're also drowsy. There's also drowsiness. And then the post-mortem lesions. So if the birds have died and you open them up, you see yellow to gray nodules or plaques in the lungs. I'll show you photos of that now. We see it in the air sacs as well. Remember, birds, unlike mammals, they've got air sacs as well to help them breathe, not only lungs. And then also these lesions we can see in the trachea or the air pipe, and in the peritoneal cavity. So the diagnosis is based on the clinical signs and also the PM lesions, the post-mortem lesions, together with the microscopic confirmation. So you can do microscopic confirmation, same as with mushy chicks, if you want to confirm which fungus is causing the issue. But the diagnosis can be made on the post-mortem lesion, which is typical for fungus. The differentials for aspergillosis, that means other diseases which can present similar to Aspergillus, is excessive formalin exposure. So formalin is, some hatcheries use formalin for disinfection, some broiler farms also use it. So if chicks are exposed to excessive formalin vapors, that will also irritate the trachea and can lead to open mouth gasping. Vaccine reactions, so if you're not applying the vaccines correctly, again, either at your farm or at the hatchery, then there could be possibly vaccine reactions, and they sometimes cause plugs in the trachea at the tracheal bifurcation. So where the trachea splits into the two bronchi, that can also lead to similar signs than ASPE. And also heat stress in the older birds. So usually heat stress is not a problem in the young chicks, because the chicks, they like the heat of about 33 degrees air temperature, but the older birds, they prefer the cooler housing conditions, as you've seen from the previous presentations. So the older birds, if they're exposed to high temperatures as in summer, then they can also be what typically they will have open mouth breathing or gasping. The treatment is none. It's a fungal infection. So some people do spray their broiler house environment with antifungal after the problem has been detected. But the efficacy thereof is questionable. So Aspergillus is something which should be addressed at the source. So as I said, either it comes from the hatchery or they can be exposed to the bedding. So you must firstly establish where does it come from. You can establish by having your bedding tested. So when the bedding, your shavings or your straw or your husks or whatever you use, when it gets to your farm, send it to a laboratory that can test for yeast and mold and fungi, and let them test for that. And the allowable limit is normally 500 colonies per gram of shavings. That's how much we allow. So even in the hatchery as well, the hatchery must have any hatchery will have a testing program where they test the fluff. And then the fluff, on the fluff, we also allow 500 colonies of fungi per gram of fluff. That just shows you how much there is in the environment. Only if it goes above 500, then we consider it as a fail. So you've got to test your bedding. Here's two photos showing what Aspergillus looks like. So the chick here on the left, you can see the open mouth, the gasping for air. They usually have have the fungus lodged in the trachea, causing obstruction of the airway. And when you open them up, you do a post-mortem on these chicks after they've died. What you can see there is the typical white round plaque caused by fungi. It looks different than a bacterial infection. This is a fungus growing there. And it grows in the air sacs, or it can grow in the lungs. There's the lung. Or it can grow, in severe cases, it can grow through any of the organs in the peritoneal cavity. So those were the two conditions affecting chicks, the mushy chicks as well as the aspergillosis. So be on the lookout for those when you are having high chick mortalities, and both of those should be prevented. So then the next condition is one which mostly affects broiler birds that are a bit older, and that is Newcastle disease. I'm sure you've heard of the dreaded Newcastle disease. So Newcastle disease is a highly contagious, in other words, it's transmitted easily between different birds. It is a highly contagious viral infection that affects many species of domestic and wild birds. So viral conditions, example, COVID currently in humans is also a viral infection, coronavirus. But the one we're dealing with here is Newcastle disease, which is a paramyxovirus. And it affects domestic poultry, as well as pigeons and parrots. These are the most susceptible. Other birds like pheasants and guinea fowls are also susceptible, but to a lesser degree than poultry and pigeons and parrots. The disease has got three manifestations. It can either manifest as a respiratory disease, or as a disease of the nervous system, or potentially a gastrointestinal tract infection. It can also be a combination of two or three of those manifestations at the same time. The incubation period is 3 to 5 days, so birds that are exposed to the virus today will show clinical signs within 3 to 5 days from today. The symptoms we see in the bird, it can range from a mild inapparent respiratory disease to a very severe depression. Sometimes it can lead to increased respiration, so a rapid respiration rate. It can lead to profuse diarrhea, so watery feces. It can then be followed by collapse, or in the case when there's nervous infections, you can also see the nervous signs such as twisted necks, and we call it stargazing, so the birds are looking up at the stars. And the severe forms of the disease are highly fatal. So Newcastle disease, together with avian influenza, These are known as the very severe diseases, the disastrous ones, and they can kill most of your flocks. So we've got to take precaution against them and make sure that our biosecurity is up to scratch to prevent these two from causing very high infection in your flock. So the Newcastle disease spreads by direct physical contact with infected or diseased birds. It can also be present in the manure and it can be breathed out. Contaminated equipment, so whether that's drinker equipment or feeding equipment or tools such as forks or spades being moved between houses, these will also carry the virus for different lengths of time. Carcasses will also harbor the virus from birds that have died from Newcastle disease. The food, the feed and the water, as well as the clothing, can also transmit this virus. And then importantly, people can also carry the virus. So what's important to remember here, as with most diseases of chickens, humans can act as asymptomatic carrier. So that means the human will get the virus or the bacteria, but we won't show clinical symptoms of the disease, but we can still transmit the virus for various lengths of time from one bird to the next bird within the same house, or from one house to the next, or from one farm to another farm. So in the case of Newcastle disease, humans could develop a mild conjunctivitis, so inflammation of the conjunctiva around the eye, but we don't show other clinical symptoms such as the birds do. But importantly, we can still transmit the virus between farms or between chicken houses. So again, the post-mortem lesions, so when birds have died from Newcastle disease, what will be shown on post-mortem? We see a swelling of the head and the neck region. There can also be swelling or bleeding and necrosis of the lymphoid tissue. So a bird has got lymphoid tissue, which is involved in the antibody response. So there's various lymphoid tissues. The one shown here at the photo at the bottom, these are the cecal tonsils, which occur at the cecal bifurcation, which is at the colon. So here you can see there's inflammation and bleeding of the cecal tonsils. Another post-mortem sign is bleeding in the trachea, also bleeding in the proventriculus, which is the first part of the chicken stomach. We'll see some photos of that now. And then also bleeding in the intestinal mucosa. So this photo here at the top is of a trachea, which is inflamed, called tracheitis. So you can see there's tracheitis in this bird. There's also some other viral diseases in chickens, such as bronchitis virus or laryngotracheitis or avian influenza. These can all cause tracheitis. So when you do see the tracheitis, you've got to make sure to identify which pathogen is causing it. And then importantly, I've previously pointed to avian influenza, which together with Newcastle disease, we call the catastrophic diseases. So they can wipe out most of your birds, and the post-mortem signs and also the clinical signs we see with Newcastle disease is indistinguishable from highly pathogenic avian influenza. So birds suffering from either of these two diseases, avian influenza or Newcastle disease, will present with similar symptoms as well as post-mortem lesions. Then more photos of birds infected with Newcastle disease. The first photo here on the top left is a greenish diarrhea from birds with Newcastle disease when they've got the enteric or the gastrointestinal infection. The second photo on the top right is what we refer to as the twisted necks and the stargazing. And bottom left here is another photo of a bird suffering from Newcastle disease, the neurological signs. And then, as we pointed out, there's bleeding in the first part of the stomach, which is the proventriculus. And there you can see bleeding in the glands of the proventriculus. To the left here, you can see the gizzard, the muscular stomach. But with Newcastle disease, also with avian influenza and one or two other diseases, we see bleeding in the glands of the proventriculus. And this photo here on the right, that's one of a lung. The chicken lung, so normally the chicken lung should be moist and pink. But in this case, the lung is hemorrhagic, so there's bleeding in the lung. It's also congested and swollen. So this is an abnormal lung from a bird that died from Newcastle disease. And then Newcastle disease can also cause swelling around the eye and also infection of the infraorbital sinuses. So the sinuses of the nose, there's inflammation and infection of these sinuses. And also you can see there's a reddening of this lesion around the eye caused by Newcastle disease. So how do we treat Newcastle disease? As we've said at the start, it is a viral infection. Antibiotics could be indicated in case there's secondary bacterial infections. But if you're only suffering from Newcastle disease, if it's a bad infection, you'll have very high mortalities and birds will die acutely. So antibiotics would not be indicated. The virus can remain infectious in manure for 2 months and on dead carcasses for 12 months. So that's a very long time. So if you were unfortunate to have had Newcastle on your farm, you've got to make sure that the disposal of the manure as well as the disposal of the carcasses gets done in a proper way, either by incineration or burial or composting. So just contact your state vet to assist you in that, because this material will remain infectious for a long time. Fortunately, disinfectants as well as sunlight and heat does kill the virus. So prevention for Newcastle disease relies on good biosecurity as well as quarantine procedures as well as vaccination. So biosecurity, we'll get talk a bit more about biosecurity on another slide, but biosecurity, the importance of biosecurity can't be overemphasized in chicken farming. And then, as I said, there's a vaccine available for Newcastle disease, and if you do farm broilers in South Africa, or any chicken for that matter, and actually in any part of the world, it would be foolish to not vaccinate your birds against Newcastle disease. Typically, broilers are vaccinated at the hatchery, and then again once or twice or even three times on your broiler farm. So in short, there's two types of vaccines available to vaccinate against Newcastle disease. Remember, when we vaccinate birds against any disease, we present them with the virus or the bacteria or the protozoa, and then the bird's immune system respond by making antibodies. And when they do get an infection from the field or the field, then the antibodies which they've produced in response to vaccination, these will then attack the virus or the bacteria and help combat the infection. So the two types of vaccines available for Newcastle, it's either live vaccines, or the second option, which is newer technology, is a vectored vaccine. The live vaccines are applied, it's applied through mass application. So either it's applied at the hatchery as a spray or on your farm as a spray or through the drinking water. And then the second option is a vectored vaccine, which is newer technology. So what happens there is scientists have discovered which part of the Newcastle virus is immunogenic. In other words, they've discovered which part of the Newcastle virus will stimulate the immune system and induce an antibody response. They also then figured out which part of the gene of the Newcastle virus or of the genome codes for that protein. So then they managed to cut that gene out of the Newcastle virus and insert it into the Marex. Marex is also a virus, but they've inserted it into the Marex virus. And then these are the birds are then vaccinated with the Marex virus, which acts as the vector. So it's the carrier for the Newcastle virus. And then the bird will then produce antibodies against both Marex and the Newcastle disease. So there's pros and cons to both the live and the vectored vaccines, but we won't be discussing that today. But the vectored vaccines, they have to be applied individually. So the live vaccines are applied through mass application, so spray or drinking water, whereas the Marex vaccine is the vectored vaccines are applied individually, usually through subcut injection at the hatchery, or they can be applied in ovo. So they get injected into the egg when the eggs are transferred during incubation at the hatchery. So that was Newcastle disease. That then brings us to our second disease, which is also a viral disease known as infectious bursal disease. Again, it's a highly contagious viral infection. This one is caused by a Brna virus, and it's also known as Gumboro disease. So infectious bursal disease and Gumboro disease is exactly the same thing. And what this disease does, it targets the bursal component of the immune system. And we'll elaborate on that soon as to what the bursal component of the immune system is. So this is a highly persistent virus. It can stay in the litter for up to 122 days. So this also, again, back to biosecurity, especially for Gambora, it's very important to make sure you've got a good cleaning and disinfection program between flocks. So when you've caught the birds and you've removed the litter from your house, you've got to make sure that there's a proper cleaning and disinfection taking place to make sure you get rid of the IBD virus so that it doesn't transmit from one flock to the next flock. So this virus has got immunosuppressive effects. So what it does, it suppresses the immune system, and that then results in poor uniformity of your birds. You see wet litter, so again we see diarrhea. There's respiratory problems. We see poor response to vaccination because, as I've pointed out, when you vaccinate birds, we induce the immune system to produce antibodies. So when birds are infected with Gambora disease, then they're not able to respond to the vaccine the way they should. It can also predispose birds to coccidiosis, which is a protozoal infection of the intestines. It can also lead to necrotic enteritis, which is a disease of the intestines caused by bacteria. It can also lead to runting and stunting. So it basically affects the bird's growth, and it also leads to poor uniformity. So whereas I said Newcastle and avian influenza are catastrophic diseases, the IBD or Gambora is more of a, we call it an erosive disease. So it doesn't really, it could kill a lot of birds, but more commonly it affects the bird's growth and also the feed intake. And it doesn't kill as many birds as you'd see with Newcastle disease or avian influenza. So as we said, it affects the bursal component of the immune system. So what do we mean by that? So the bursa of Fabricius, or commonly just known as the bursa, is part of the immune system. It is a round organ which is situated at the close to the cloaca, just above the colon. And in this photo at the top, I'm pointing to this is the bursa of Fabricius, and it occurs in all chickens or all birds up to a certain age. In mature or older birds, you won't find it anymore. And the function of this is it's part of the primary lymphatic system, and maturation of B lymphocytes happen there. So the B lymphocytes are produced in the bone marrow, and then they go to the bursa, where they mature and form part of the immune system. In mammals, there's no bursa; it's only present in birds. So what we'll get to it now, but what the virus does is it attacks the bursa. It can lead to swelling of the bursa, so enlargement of the bursa, and then can also lead to bleeding in the bursa. So the photo you see here on the left is one of a bursa which has been opened, and there you can see the small hemorrhages. And then on the right you see a more severe infection, and there we see a bursa which is completely filled with blood. So the symptoms for IBD, the incubation period is also short, it's 2 to 3 days. We see a rapid drop in feed and water consumption. We see diarrhea. Secondary to the diarrhea, which is watery droppings, we see soiled vent feathers. The birds are not feeling well, they also have fever. So in response to that, you see ruffled feathers. The birds are listless, they will have an unsteady gait, or they could be sitting in a hunched position and also picking at their own vent. So in young birds less than 3 weeks of age, the infection with IBD is usually subclinical, whereas in older birds of 3 weeks and older, it can often be they're more susceptible to a clinical disease. And the mortality is usually lower than 20%, but it can be as high as 60%. So the post-mortem of Gambora, so when the birds have died and you open them up, what do we see? We've seen previous photos of the bursa. So the bursa, firstly, it swells up, and then it can also become hemorrhagic and atrophies. In other words, it becomes smaller in the later stages of the disease. Then we also see hemorrhage in the thigh muscle, which is illustrated in this photo here. You see bleeding in the muscles of the thigh. There's also hemorrhage in the proventriculus. Similar, remember I said with Newcastle disease and avian influenza, we also see bleeding in the proventriculus. Here's the proventriculus. Birds will also be dehydrated because they've got diarrhea. And then you can also see swollen kidneys with urates. So urates is a buildup of uric acid. Remember, birds don't have a bladder. They've got six kidneys, but no bladder, so birds don't urinate. They hold the watery component of the urine back, and they excrete the uric acid or the urates together with the droppings. So in case of IBD or anything causing diarrhea, you can see swollen kidneys with accumulation of urates, which is white within the kidneys or the tubes going from the kidneys. So how does IBD spread? It spreads through direct contact, also through equipment, same as Newcastle disease, and then dust and insects can also spread IBD, importantly again between flocks. So when you catch out the birds, it could be that the litter beetles or the mites or other insects can also harbor the virus and then transmit it from your one flock to the next flock. There's no vertical spread of the disease. Vertical spread means that when the breeder birds are infected with the disease, the antigen, so the virus or the bacteria, then gets included in the yolk during the formation of the egg, and the broiler chick hatches with the disease. That's important in some diseases like Salmonella and also in mycoplasma, but in the case of IBD, infectious bursal disease, there's no vertical spread, so the chick can't get the disease from the breeder birds. And then also it's a viral infection, so there's no treatment, and only supportive therapies are indicated, which in your case may be something like vitamins and electrolytes. So then in IBD, the good quality chicks are vital for IBD prevention. Why do we say that? Because even though the chicks can't get the disease from the hens, they do get the antibodies from the hens. And the antibodies specifically for IBD are transferred from the hen via the yolk to the chick. So when you get a good quality day-old chick, it should have a high level of maternal antibodies. That means it gets a good level of maternal antibodies from the breeder birds, because the breeder birds have been vaccinated against Gambora disease. So what happens is, over time then, the chick hatches with a certain level of antibodies, and then that declines over time. So therefore, based on that, we then predict at what age the bird should be vaccinated. So a bird hatches with a certain number of these antibodies that then decline over time. So over the broiler's life, whether you slaughter your bird at 30 days or 40 days or even older, the antibodies it gets from the breeder hen is not sufficient to protect it for life. So therefore, we have to vaccinate the broilers against Gambora disease as well. And then for the same reason, because different breeder flocks can have different levels of maternal antibodies against Gambora, it's better to not combine chicks from different parent flocks into one house, and to avoid that. Rather go for a single flock placement, or if you are placing various flocks into one broiler house, various breeder flocks, it's also best to keep the age difference between them small, so typically less than 10 weeks. We prevent IBD, we prevent it through good biosecurity. Okay, so there was a previous talk on biosecurity, so you can go and review that. Biosecurity in the chicken industry is very important. We can't overemphasize the importance of that. And then also with chick quality, as I've said, the chicks get the maternal antibodies from the hen via the yolk. So you've got to make sure you get chicks with a good number of maternal antibodies against Gambora disease. And then again, we vaccinate for Gambora disease in South Africa. There's different types of vaccines. So you get a mild strain, you get intermediate strains, you get a strong strain. I can't comment on which one is best for you. You've got to contact your local poultry expert and poultry veterinarian, or and just ask what's going on in the field, and for your situation, your challenge situation, which vaccine is recommended. And then the time to administer the vaccine. So as I've said, there's a regular or constant decline of maternal antibodies during the broiler's life. So as the broiler gets older, the number of maternal antibodies get less, and then you have to decide at what age do you vaccinate to boost the immune system again. So it's illustrated by this graph here. So what we see with this line, which slopes from left to right, that is the number of maternal antibodies, which declines over the age, and the X axis here shows the age of the broilers. So if you vaccinate too early, which is demonstrated here by the two red bars, then the vaccine is a antigen, so a virus in this case, then the antibodies which the chick got from the hen will destroy the vaccine virus. So you've got to determine at what age to vaccinate. Otherwise, you'll have this open. If you vaccinate too late again, you're going to have an unprotected zone where the birds are not protected by the maternal antibodies or by the vaccine. So yeah, you've got to get the timing right when you administer the vaccine, and then also you've got to have a proper administration of the vaccine, which is a topic for another day. But these are typically live vaccines against Gambola. There's also vectored vaccines and antigen antibody complex vaccines to use against these. So contact your local poultry veterinarian to just ask them to guide you on a vaccination strategy against Gambora. So those were the two viral disease of older birds, Newcastle disease and Gambora. Then the next topic we're looking at is how to identify broiler health problems. So to identify any abnormality in life, you first got to know what normal looks like. So how do you get to know what is normal for chicken farming? So those of you who've been farming for many years, over time you would have observed what's normal behavior for the birds. But for those of you who started off recently, you've got to learn to spend time with your flock, see what's normal bird behavior, and only then you'll be able to recognize what is abnormal. So you also have to limit farm blindness. What do I mean by farm blindness? Farm blindness means you expose to your farm all the time and you see your birds behave in a certain way and you start to think that's normal, but maybe it's not normal. So you've got to ask your friends who are also poultry experts to come to your farm, obviously observe good biosecurity practices, or visit their farms and also see, you know, what's happening at their farm. Don't get into the habit of thinking that what happens at your farm is normal, because maybe it's not. And then importantly, don't only look at the technical aspects. So these days, it's very important to measure a lot of things throughout the broiler cycle. So you measure temperature, you can measure humidity. We record daily feed consumption, water consumption. You can measure ammonia and we measure air exchange. But there's no substitute for using your senses. So always use your senses when evaluating the flock. Use your sight, use your hearing, use your taste, use your smell, and then evaluate what the birds are doing to get to know what is normal and what is not. And then also do frequent inspections beside the usual tasks. So your usual task would be changing fans and observing the waterline heights and turning the litter. So when you do those things, of course, you observe the flock, but also make sure to take time out every day and just sit inside the broiler house and check what the birds are doing to get to know what the normal behavior looks like. And then look from the flock to the chicken. So look at the overall picture. How are the birds behaving? Are they huddling? Are they getting cold and then they huddle, or are they sitting down because the air current is too strong and the birds aren't getting up to walk? But then also observe individual birds. So pick up the birds, observe them. Are they having any, are they having feed in the crop? Are they dehydrated? So you look at both the flock, but also look at individual chickens. And then evaluate if the birds are alert and active. So look at the behavior of the birds. Are they eating? Are they drinking? Are they resting? Usually about a third of the birds should be eating, a third should be drinking, and a third of the birds should be resting. So evaluate these things and check what your bird behavior is like. And over time and with experience, you will become good at that. And then also evaluate the droppings of the birds. So the droppings or the feces can tell us a lot about the intestinal health of the birds. And I'll show you some pictures now of what's normal and what's not. And then also pick up the birds and assess the individual birds. So the intestinal droppings, and don't overlook this, get into the habit of getting to observe the droppings in the chicken house. So on the left is a good dropping, which is of good consistency and of good color. And what you see, the white section here on the left, that portion is the uric acid, which I've referred to earlier. So as I said, birds don't urinate, the uric acid gets excreted together with the feces. They hold back the water and excrete the uric acid part of what would be normal urine. And then this one in the middle is still acceptable. And then the one on the right is below standard. You can see it's watery and it's not of a good consistency. Then abnormal droppings. So as we see here, is there's an orange mucus. The picture on the left shows an orange mucus. This is not blood, okay? I often get called by people saying that there's chicken, and they send me a picture of this. This is not blood, this is just orange mucus. It's usually the cells of the intestinal lining which is coming off because of whatever's irritating the gut. And then the picture in the middle shows undigested feed. So there's feed passage, so the feed is coming through and not being absorbed. There could also be various causes of that. And then the one on the right, we see green droppings. Remember I said that with Newcastle disease, we also see a green diarrhea. There's also other conditions that can cause green droppings. It could be an excess bile being secreted in the droppings as well. And then more abnormal droppings. The one on the left is foamy. Usually that's also from a dysbacteriosis, meaning there's an abnormal content of bacteria or the types of bacteria in the gut. The one in the middle is a bloody dropping. So this one is blood. Commonly coccidiosis, which is a protozoa growing in the gut, can cause bloody droppings, or there could be other causes of bloody droppings as well. And then the photo on the right, this shows diarrhea. So it's a watery content of the droppings with a poor consistency. So then besides using your senses and observing the flock, we also have to get reliable records. These will also assist yourself in establishing if something is abnormal, and then also it will assist someone like a veterinarian or the EPL nutritionist or the EPL sales representative coming onto your farm. They will rely on records that you can present. So you've got to get into the habit of taking very good records which are accurate and reliable. So some examples of these are the daily mortalities and the culls. So record the mortalities each day. So how many birds have died over the previous 24 hours? And also how many birds have you culled? So distinguish between those two, how many died and how many have culled. Typically a normal figure for mortalities would be about 1% per week. So if you grow the birds for 5 weeks or 35 days, you should aim for maximum loss of about 5%. If you break that up into a daily mortality, that's 0.15% per day. So that's 1.5 birds for every 1,000 birds. That's total loss, mortalities and culls. So that's something to, that should be the upper limit. And then the daily feed, feed intake and daily water consumption, you can also record that, because if the birds aren't feeling well, then they'll also be eating less and drinking less water. And then also the house temperatures. So get into the habit of recording the house temperatures. And remember, when you are in the house during the day, it could be a nice day outside, but especially now it's winter, it's cold outside, even below freezing point. So you've got to put a maybe a logger in the house to record temperatures during the night as well, so that you can know what's happening with the temperatures at night. So then the next section is preventing broiler health problems. So to prevent broiler health problems, we first have to ask ourselves what causes broiler health problems and what determines if a bird will develop disease. And this is illustrated through the disease triangle, which is a model that shows the interaction between the three determinants, which then determine whether disease will develop or whether it will not develop. And this doesn't only go for chickens. This disease pyramid can be applied to any animal or even plant species or even humans. So there's an interaction for the birds to develop disease. Of course, there's got to be a pathogen present, whether it's a bacteria or a virus or a fungi or a protozoa. There's also got to be a susceptible host. So the host or the population of hosts has got to be susceptible, and there's got to be a favorable environment. And all, if all those three those factors or determinants are present, only then could we possibly have disease manifesting. So we can take COVID for example. So if the pathogen is, because COVID is now a hot topic and everyone is talking about it, so if the pathogen, so in that case the coronavirus is present, but there's not a susceptible host, so either the person has been vaccinated, or obviously there's no vaccine available yet, hopefully there will be soon, but if the person has been vaccinated or has got a good immune system, then even though the pathogen is present, then disease will not manifest. So in the case of chickens as well, the pathogen, we refer to the bacteria or the virus, they've got to be present for disease to manifest. There's got to be a susceptible host. So we've spoken about vaccines before. So if we vaccinate birds against diseases that we can vaccinate against, then the host become less susceptible because they've got a certain number of antibodies against those specific diseases. So a vaccinated bird will then be less susceptible than a non-vaccinated bird if that specific pathogen is present and the birds have been vaccinated against that pathogen. And then also a favorable environment. So if the environment is favorable for the development of the disease, in your case, the environment points to the air in the chicken house, the bedding material in the chicken house, as I said, the quality of the air, also the availability of feed and good quality water. If those are not available, then it's also more likely that the bird will develop disease. And the important thing to remember as a broiler farmer is that with these three factors, the pathogen, the susceptible host, and the favorable environment, you are in control of all three of these. And by controlling these three, you have an impact on whether whether your birds will develop disease or not. So you must remember that through biosecurity and through proper vaccination and also through managing the environment, you can have an impact on whether clinical disease manifests or not. And then prevention of disease is based on three pillars. So firstly, good biosecurity. So I've referred to biosecurity before, and there's been a talk earlier in this, a presentation earlier in the series on biosecurity. So do go and review that again. But I just want to say on biosecurity, why is biosecurity so important in specifically the chicken industry? It is because it's an intensive farming system. That means we're producing a lot of meat in per square meter. So we can look at chickens and also pigs in South Africa is typically reared intensively. So you in chicken farming, you've got 10 or 15 or 20 birds per square meter. And within one airspace, so within one house, you've got 30,000 birds, 40,000 birds. Nowadays, the houses even have 50,000 birds. Even if you're a small-scale farmer and you've only got 100 or a few hundred birds in one house, that is still a lot of birds. So therefore, once disease gets into your farm, it will spread like a field fire, especially something like the viral diseases like Newcastle. So at all costs, you have to prevent the pathogen or the virus or the bacteria from getting onto your farm. So therefore, in the chicken industry, the importance of biosecurity cannot be overemphasized. So do make sure that you apply proper biosecurity measures at your farm. And then also we've got to start off with a good quality day-old chick. So there's a saying that broiler farming is like a Formula One race. So there's no time for mishaps. And if you start with a bad quality day-old chick, you already start on the back foot. So you've got to start off with a good quality day-old chick. Okay, there was also previous talks on chick quality. You've got to make sure the chick comes from a hatchery that's incubated the eggs properly. So the chick has got to be in a good condition and have a well-heeled navel, like we've pointed out during the mushy chick presentation. So you've got to start off with a good quality day-old chick. And then also, you've got to have good stockmanship and a good environment. So the definition of stockmanship, it simply means being able to care properly for animals. So if a good stockman is then also someone who can use his or her senses and also is able to differentiate between normal and abnormal. So if you are a good stockman, then you will be able to see what's abnormal on your broiler farm. And that is done by, as I said, using your senses and also the measurements, not only your senses, but also the measures you take and your records. And therefore, you can act early. So a good stockman will be able to act early and detect that something is wrong. And then also by a good environment. So there was previous talks in this EPOL series on proper environment for broiler farming. So you've also got to make sure that that you've got a good environment, because as we pointed out in the disease triangle, there's interaction between a susceptible host and between the pathogen. But also the environment also plays a big role. It's often underestimated or overlooked, and the environment plays a big role in whether disease will manifest or not. That then brings me to the end of my presentation, but please stick around because there will now be a question and answer session. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that presentation. I think we all enjoyed it. Lots of handy information and useful information that I'm sure will stand us in good stead as broiler farmers in managing our disease on farm. Looking at our first question, we've got a question from Lindile. And the question is, I have a problem with my broilers. Some don't eat and they die. Inside their stomachs, they have a jelly liquid and it's yellow. The gallbladder is also very big. What is the cause? I think before Andrew starts answering, obviously when we get these questions, we try our best to answer as accurately as possible. But, you know, being a veterinarian or a nutritionist, you're looking for as much clues as possible to do your investigation. So Andrew's going to give it his best shot with the information at hand. And thank you for that, Andrew. So if you don't mind, Andrew, answering this question for us.
Thank you, Stefan. Lindile, looking at the questions, you're describing some of the birds are not eating, and inside the stomachs where you should be finding the feed, you're not finding the feed, and also the enlarged gallbladder that you're seeing, that just ties up with the fact that they're not eating, so the gall is not being excreted into the intestines. So to answer your question on what the cause is, I think firstly we've got to establish whether there's an infectious agent at play here or whether it's simply the environment or the chick quality, meaning or resulting in them not taking in the feed. So I think firstly you've got to make sure that there is good quality feed and water available, and then you also have to observe, you know, what number of birds is experiencing this. But yeah, so firstly go and check at your house temperatures, the ventilation in the house, is there enough fresh air coming into the house, and then also is there constantly feed available. And then also you can, if some of them have died, then you can get someone to do a post-mortem and get more info. But yeah, I'd say firstly you've got to establish what the reason is why these birds are not eating. Is it because of a feed availability issue, or is it potentially because of the housing environment? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for that, Andrew. Our second question is from Tinashe, and we've got a picture of a broiler chicken lying on its back, and the question is, I found this guy like this. This is the second one. What can this be? Andrew, your opinion?
Thank you, Tinashe, for the photo. So that's a bird which has died on its back. It looks like a broiler which has, it's not a dehydrated bird or a run, so it looks like a well-grown broiler. Typically, when you do see birds dying in this way, it could be that they died from sudden death syndrome or what we call a flip. So that is also known as a heart failure. It's more commonly seen in the male birds. Because of the rapid growth rate, sometimes the heart muscle can't keep up with supplying blood to the whole body. And then these birds die from what we call, yeah, it's a congested heart failure or flip. But to confirm that, you would have to do post-mortem on these ones, to open up and look at the lungs. Is there fluid or blood in the lungs? Also, are the hearts enlarged? Again, to know whether the heart's enlarged or not, you'll have to know what the normal size heart looks like. So do contact if you've got a veterinarian, a poultry vet or a state veterinarian nearby. And then if that is determined to be the cause, you've got to address that. One of the ways to address it would be through the lighting program. So maybe you could alter the lighting program, and if there's too rapid growth, you can maybe give the birds more darkness at night. So I'm not sure what the program is, but that could be something. Thank you, Stefan.
Great, thanks, Andrew. The third question is from Shane, and I think Andrew's addressed part of the question already in terms of lighting program. But the question is, I have broiler chickens, and the flooring is of pine tree sawdust. A few died, and when I checked them in their mouth, I found sawdust. Again, is it possible to only feed them once a day? Of course, I make sure that they always have feed and water. They eat until they can't even walk themselves or carry themselves. So I think, again, like Andrew said, in terms of lighting program, you can work with that and ensure that you control feed intake in that manner. But I think, Andrew, if you can assist us with the question about the sawdust that was found in the chick's mouths.
Shane, so typically broilers are fed ad lib. That means they've got feed available at all times. So a broiler should have feed available at all times. If they had feed available from day one of placement, they would regulate the feed intake and not overindulge. So I think you've got to make sure that from the start, when the chicks are placed, there is feed available at all times. So what you are seeing is the birds eating the bedding. That is because they want feed all the time. So when they can't find feed, then they resort to eating the bedding. And as Stefan said, you can also regulate the feed intake by the lighting program. So you can make sure that, if you've got over a 24-hour day, typically from day 7 onwards, they should have 6 or 8 hours or even more darkness, because during the dark time, the birds won't be feeding. So you can give them, or you should give them feed at lip, but then you can regulate that through the lighting program. But you've got to make sure that the birds have feed available at all times from placement.
Good. Thanks, Andrew. Our next question is from Slingiwe. And the question is, please assist. My chicks are 4 days old and they are having difficulties breathing. It's like they have blocked noses. What could be the cause and how can I help them?
So, Lengiwe, thank you for the question. There's various pathogens in chickens that cause respiratory disease. So what you are describing there sounds like a snotty infection of the nose. It could be caused by either some bronchitis viruses could present like that, or even infectious coryza. So again, in your case, as with previous questions, we've got to determine whether there's a specific pathogen present. So as like the ones I've pointed out now before, is there viral or bacterial infection, or are we maybe dealing with an environment which is not suitable? So is there enough air exchange? Is the ammonia levels and the CO2 levels under control? Is there enough fresh air available for the birds? And also, how many birds are affected? If it's a lot of birds affected, and is it spreading from one bird to the next or from one house to the next? So those would also aid you in coming to a diagnosis. But I suggest, because respiratory diseases can be caused by a variety of pathogens and other factors, in this case, it would be good to contact a poultry vet or the state vet to assist you.
Good, thanks, Andrew. Our second last question is from Marnika, and she sent us a photo of a chick with some specific lesions, it seems like, on the head of the chick. So, Andrew, she's asking, can anyone tell me what this is and what can I use to handle it? I don't know what you can make from that picture.
Marnika, that my first question would be, how many birds are affected? What percentage of your flock? Is this an individual case or a lot of birds infected? That can also point us to a possible cause. And also, are these lesions across the whole body or is it only seen on the face? It looks like there's some necrosis of the skin. It could be caused, if it's one bird or few birds affected, it could be caused by trauma. So maybe the bird got its head stuck somewhere. It could also be mites. So mites can cause an infection of the follicles of the feathers or of the skin. So you've got to look for possibly mites causing the dermatitis. Otherwise, it could be a pox virus as well. So pox virus is a virus transmitted by most commonly mosquitoes between birds. And then they cause, the pox virus causes wart-like lesions on the parts of the body which doesn't have feathers. So on the shanks and on the face, you start seeing wart-like lesions caused by pox. So I'd say it could be trauma, it could be mites causing a skin infection, or even it could be pox. Thank you, Stefan.
Good, thanks, Andrew, for that. Our final question, we've got another picture here, and the question is, what's the likely cause and solution to the swollen legs and hand, as the question is put, so I guess it's feet in this case. Andrew, if you can just have a look for us at that photo and give us an idea.
So most commonly, this swollen feet or legs is more common than seeing the swollen wings. Typically, the swollen wings could be caused by an infectious disease, something like some of the mycoplasmas. Mycoplasma synovia can cause the swollen wings or the infection of the wing joint. The photo that you've sent us here shows a picture of the swollen foot. It could be what's caused the bumble foot, in which case there's a lesion under the foot pad. So you've got to look as to whether there's a lesion under the foot pad and whether then there's a bacteria which come through the skin under the foot pad and cause the infection. What could also happen is, we spoke about mushy cheek earlier. Sometimes if the cheeks have got an unhealed navel, there's then a bacterial infection around the stump where the umbilicus was. And that then descends from the umbilicus into the femur, so the upper part of the leg, and then can also descend from there into the hock joint. And this photo you've shown here, the left leg does look like it could have potentially a septic infection of the hock joint. So that's one possible or another possible cause. And then also some specific viruses and bacteria do cause joint infections, such as reovirus, R-E-O, reovirus, or also, again, the mycoplasmas. And then also staphylococcus bacteria can also cause infection. That's quite a common cause in chickens, is a staphylococcus infection of the legs. Thank you, Stefan.
Great, thanks, Andrew. So with that, we come to the end of episode 8. Thank you very much to Andrew for participating and sharing his knowledge. To everybody that's tuned in, we really welcome and happy that you guys have joined us. Looking forward to your participation in future episodes, and good luck with your broiler farming ventures going forward. We wish you all success, and stay well and stay safe, and see you next week for the next episode. Thank you, everyone, and bye.